The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Everybody, and welcome to ARM Radio. I am your host, Jamie Lynn, with my amazing co-host,
Cindy Lee. Hi, everyone.
Hey, on So What's Next on ARM Radio. Check us out over there on our fan page and our group, Armed Radio, or on iHeart. So tonight, we are going to be talking about burnout, how not to burn out.
It's simple. Just say no.
What? No, I say yes to everything.
I don't wonder why. We're so tired. I know. I just texted Jamie right before this. It's like very applicable for both of us tonight, you know, as far as, hey, this is kind of like a, yep, me too. I do this whole thing, especially in the fall. So
not a hashtag topic. Me too, right?
Not a hashtag me too. No, just like me too, burnout, you know. Like, too much, but when you love to do a lot of things, it's hard to say no, you know, mm-hmm. right? When you have a lot of passion for a lot of different things, it's hard to say no, you know? So,
yeah.
It's okay to say no. So, yeah. So, talk about burnout. You're running in 10 different directions today.
Yes. I mean, it's always the same direction for me, you know, which is helping humanity and being the voice for other people when they can't. And so, yeah, this morning I was up at 5:30 a.m. downtown L.A. in court doing some advocacy work, driving home on phone calls, you know, talking to clients and people in our movement because we are trying to burn out other people intentionally in the political arena. Always with love and light, of course. Oh, always sending okay. them love, but being truthful. And then came to my office and way on the other side of Los Angeles, saw a couple clients. Then now I'm home, had to shower, do some laundry, had to get ready. I've got my notes for tonight. You know, I'm speaking to Holistic Moms, a group of moms, about, interestingly enough, how to handle stress.
I think it's just bottom line. Everybody's looking at how to do that, right? How to handle this.
Should I mention I drove in from Sacramento last night?
You could. I think that you should just pile it on. Like, tell us the story.
Just pile it. Okay. So I was in Atlanta. I was in Chicago. Then I was in Atlanta. Then I was in Los Angeles. Then I was in Sacramento. Now I'm back in Los Angeles. Now I'm heading to San Bernardino.
Yeah. And part of why we're doing this tonight instead of tomorrow night, which we're not sure we're going to be on Tuesday nights coming off of Sunday. So we're looking into that. But with the election coming, we just decided, hey, let's jump on today, talk about this topic. I think there are a lot of people that are feeling this right now for a variety of different reasons. The election definitely, you know, kind of can create a more tense time for people. So glad to be on tonight kind of looking at this. So, and what is burnout? And did you look up anything on, you know, burnout, the different definitions? It's very interesting how, well, you know, you being in your field and me being in mine, you know, as far as you diagnose things, I do not, right? However, it's very interesting because they can't agree on nor decide how to diagnose burnout, right? Kind of an interesting topic coming from, you know, a licensed marriage therapist, clinician, that you can diagnose things. How do you feel about that idea of diagnosing burnout, you know, valid, not valid? What is it important? Is it not? You know, what would determine who has burnout and who doesn't?
Wow, that's a whole can of worms asking me that mm-hmm. question as a clinician about diagnosing people. You know, to logistically answer your question, not necessarily myself, but an individual in the field would look at panic attacks or generalized anxiety disorder with or without agoraphobia. So agoraphobia is a big fancy word for when you struggled being around people. Agoraphobia is usually when people like to be by themselves. They get really anxious and stressed out when they're around other people. Then you've got the other end of the spectrum of depression. Mm-hmm. Or if you're super, super stressed, then usually we look at post-traumatic stress disorder because that's a trauma. So at the clinical end of this, you would look at diagnosing people, but you and I have talked about this a lot is mm-hmm. I don't really necessarily like the diagnosis because of a few reasons. I find it that sometimes people in our field end up bullying when it comes to that. They end up just writing them off and telling them to go take medications and treat it from a neurological perspective. And then that leads into the third reason, which is perpetuating a mindset, a spiritual or a cognitive at the same time, the mind-body-soul connection of a victim mentality. Mm-hmm. So that's my long-winded answer on being in the mental health field and diagnosing people. What about you as a coach? How do you look at people?
Well, I don't, you know, for me, I have people that come in that have a diagnosis from a different, you know, from a therapist or a doctor as far as what they have. And for me, I always set it in the corner and say, that's great, but let's put it over there and find out what you want or where you're at today. And, you know, I just find it interesting that our society for a lot of the good reasons, as far as like, why do we diagnose? Well, you know, sometimes it's to get extra services, you know, extra support and services that we may need. Right. But a lot of these things, like if somebody came into my office that, you know, diagnosed, but they don't have a standard diagnosis, you know, system around burnout, you know, it's that chronic fatigue as far as like just so tired. And for me in coaching, I see it as a up against resistance all the time, that you're fighting this resistance in yourself, whether it's, you know, something you want to be doing or not want to be doing. Like we just said, you know, just say no. Well, it's not necessarily that simple, or just say yes to yourself or however you want to view it. But
right.
I see a lot of burnout again, well, quote, you know, in quotations, as this resistance, against kind of the flow of what you actually desire to have in life, and you're, you know, kind of overdoing or, you know, working on your high marks as far as a perfectionist and getting everything right and doing what's right or what's expected or the shoulds of society. I think that, you know, sometimes those burnout pieces come from I'm shoulding myself so much that I'm exhausted trying to meet all these markers that society says we need to be. And when you just are like, I can't, I don't even know if I want to anymore. But then the flip side of the guilt of the burnout of feeling that guilt too. So it's this kind of double-edged sword. Like, where do you find that balance to keep, you know, yourself in check, to not feel so burned out all the time? And I think that you and I are a perfect example. I mean, we're both single mothers of four kids. That in itself is burnout. You know, I love them dearly. However, you know, it's a lot of work in a wonderful way, but you know, then you do career stuff and responsibilities as a parent and, you know, whatever it may be, just your household chores. And so it can add up to a lot of stuff. And we know a lot of people have a lot of that stuff going on in their lives right now.
Yeah. And going back to burnout and defining burnout is, where do you draw the line in the sand and respecting other people's burnout compared to your own? So yeah. I always look at things, you know, on the continuum, because my level of burnout is vastly different on a spectrum, on a scale of 0 to 10, than other people's burnout. So I think that's fair to just say, if you're burned out, can you categorically list the things in your life that are, you know, defining your burnout? And then going back to your just saying yes or just saying no, or if you don't want to cut anything and you're like me, where you're just like, yes, 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 go, go, go. Mm-hmm. Choosing your mind, controlling your mind, learning how to cope with the things at hand. It's kind of like a police officer, a priest, a Olympic athlete. So you can take people from various professions and they can each define their own level of what burnout would be considered. So I think that's the first starting point where you draw the line in the sand. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And I think that you're making a great point here, and it kind of goes back to last week's show on judgment. So allowing people to determine what their own level of fatigue or burnout is. And that something that you, I mean, I know I can take a lot more than the average person. Not that that's a great thing. It just right. is that I see myself doing in general, but that doesn't mean that I should somebody else to hold those same standards of let's hit this mark, you know, 50,000 times in a row, like what, you know, really letting go of judgment, allowing people to know that. And, you know, our society so honors this over busyness. Like, I can't wait until the day where people say, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm being bored and I freaking love it. You know, when's the last time you're bored? Actually, my daughter said to me today, I'm bored. I said, that's fantastic. She said, why is that fantastic? I said, because next week you'll be running around telling me how you don't have any time for yourself. Crazy. You have too much to do. So like, I like how you were bringing that in. Know your own level. And this is that self-reflection. So as you're coming out of this place of I'm over fatigued, overdone, burned out, and as you're putting in skill sets to move away from that or have a healthier balance of, you know, that mind, body, soul balance, as far as how you're showing up in your life, that you're going to be getting better relative to your own marker, not somebody else's. So try not to compare or contrast yourself with others or place judgment. Like, they should be able to do more. They should be able to handle more.
No? Yeah. The infamous right? shoulds. I know.
Right?
And that goes back to, I think, the judgment episode that we had last week was so amazing and fun and could be talked about for probably a whole year straight, because I think this is where it plays in, is judgment and looking at yourself and then the judgment of other people and defining the level of burnout and how much you could take it. So maybe we could give again a little bit of strategy stuff on how to not burn out, right? So what's next when you start to feel like you're burning out? So I guess I could start. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Okay. So I can't recall her name, and I apologize if she's watching now or is going to watch this. I got a message last night when I drove back in from Sacramento, right? So it's about a 7.5-hour, 8-hour drive there and back. And we're up there for some educational, you know, we're a nonprofit that's educational based. So we're always educating people on healthy aspects, mind, body, spirit, healthy consciousness when it comes to, you know, pollution, our food, our water, our air, our homelessness, our mental health, all those things. So I come home and I have this message from a woman I've never met before. And she basically, it was like this, you need to take it easy, like take care of yourself. And I was like, okay. Like, is that how people are seeing me? And that brings up a lot of self-judgment based off of other people's judgment of me. And I didn't know her. And I can't recall what I said back. I think I said, do I know you? And why would you say something like that? And she said, well, you just look tired. And then I sat and I thought, and the last couple lives I've been doing to educate people and to catch people up in our own arena, I think I mentioned once or twice I was tired. And it was true. I mean, I had walked 16 hours one day from the moment we woke up to the moment we went to bed. We were out on the streets educating people about healthy choices and healthy opportunities and choosing a, you know, Eric Frame in the election, because decisions of those politicians affects the entire state and then other states that might try to pass that same legislation. And I mentioned I was tired. I mean, yeah, I was walking for 16 hours and then I had been driving. And so I had to stop and think like a box. So a compartment, we call it compartmentalizing. I think we talked about it, is in that box, how does somebody see me? And then in that box, looking outside at them seeing me. I wish I had the whiteboard, but I hope that makes sense to you all. And, you know, I wanted to be empathetic and not be defensive and come at, you know, that person in a way to just be like, what do you mean? Like, I'm fine. I mean, that's common. Like, I'm fine. What are you talking about? But it, you know, it was reflective in this box. It's like, okay, yeah, I did mention that. And it's like, oh, like, I totally appreciate you. Thank you for worrying about me. Cause she then went on to mention like, you know, I was just worried about you. And then my mind wanted to go back to other things where I have burned out. I've definitely had my meltdowns of burnout. And have learned. So that first tool for me is, I think we talked about it, is to not be reactive and to what is that other person seeing in me that I might not be seeing in myself? So I'm the observer. That's the one, the first tool when I'm thinking about burning out, because maybe other people could be right. Do I look like I'm burning out on the outside and I'm just doing that? I'm fine.
Yeah. And that is that self-reflection and the observation of somebody bringing that to your attention. And then in that moment saying, hey, thanks for that heads up. And you wouldn't say this, but right back at you, here's the mirror. Because remember, they couldn't see that in Jamie if they already weren't present with that in themselves or have experienced that in themselves. So maybe perhaps they were a high burnout person and have done some really great tools and skill sets and have a little bit more balance around that burnout. And maybe they're seeing in you something that used to be in them, or it's a current situation in them. So taking that pause, that gratitude of, hey, thanks. Hey, we're going to have it tonight.
You inspired me.
Taking that moment to not be defensive and just be in that place of gratitude of, hey, thanks. And that's it. Not like, oh my God, what am I doing? Do people really see that I'm as tired? Do I need to do something in my face? Like, am I getting old? Whatever it may be. Right. But that's exactly it. Hey, thank you. And avoid the judgment in self and rather get curious. Like, I guess I am a little bit tired. Have I been sleeping well? How's my nutrition? You know, how's my sugar intake? My God, we come off of Halloween and ta-da, right? Halloween into election, Halloween into, like, here in Minnesota, it's dark outside by 5:30. So we don't see the sun much, right? So things like that. So observation and gratitude of, hey, thanks for that little wink of check on in at what you're doing. So what do you do after you observe, Jamie? What's your next step?
So after I observe from the person outside looking in, then I do get really quiet within myself to check in. Am I tired? And burnout for me is defined by a few things. Burnout is emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Yeah. So I will go through the boxes and check those boxes. Okay, so physically, I asked myself when this person made that comment, and that was why I thought, oh, I did make a couple comments during some lives that I was tired. So physically, was I tired? So I checked the box, which was like, oh, no, actually, she didn't know. I had been getting sleep. For the last week, I had caught myself up having come back from Chicago and Atlanta. Because when I was in Atlanta, I was not sleeping. The girls and I were getting like 3-4 hours sleep. I was working before when I was in Chicago getting like, I think when I was in Chicago, I was getting like 4 to 5 hours sleep. Then I went to Atlanta and was getting like 3-4 hours sleep. So for the last week, I had truly caught up on my sleep.
Yeah.
And so that was the box check there. Was I physically tired? No. From sleep. Then it was I physically tired from travel? Because travel can take a physical toll. That was a yes, that I was physically tired from plane after plane after plane, to being in car after car, and then different cars running around in Sacramento, and then a car back. And so, yes, I was physically tired of not having the consistency of my bed and my environment, my office. So there was that. Then it was emotionally. Was I emotionally tired? And that's something maybe we can do some role play when we get there, and I'm happy to, utilize myself. Because in my movement, I am emotionally tired. It is emotionally exhausting, but that will never go away. Having a sick child, having the world the way that my world operates when it comes to tumultuousness on how my son's treated, the court cases I'm involved in professionally, my scale of importance in life on bringing love to people, but, bringing information and truth to people, but also being very solution focused on how you get the services for your child, how you emotionally take care of yourself, kind of like the show that we're doing. So am I emotionally burnt out? Yes and no, because it's like I've learned to accept it. It's the infamous when you put the frog in the pot and you kind of turn it up, the heat up really slow, the frog doesn't jump out. So I've had my moments of being thrown in hot water and jumping out, and then I've had my moments of being the frog where it boils up. So that's the second part I go through. And then the spiritual. Because most of my energy and my ability to do number one and number two comes from the spiritual. And I'm not spiritually burnt out. I am so spiritually high, more and more over in the last couple years since I've made those choices to not drink, to not take pharmaceuticals, to surround myself with amazing people like yourself and in my own network and the work of Divine One and in my church. And so that was my long answer. And I hope that's helpful to people, is I check that box off: physical, emotional, and spiritual. And then of course I can go deeper in like diet and exercise and blah, 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 but I'll let you interject since I've been chatty Cathy over here.
Yeah, no, I want to comment about when you were talking about the emotional, which I like is it's emotionally fatiguing, but yet super inspiring. So like you gain this strength, and it's also, you know, kind of so fulfilling to continue on this work that you're doing. You know, like you said, it's not going to stop. So that's the other thing, is when people get to check in with, yes, I am doing something on a large scale, and yes, it's fatiguing emotionally, but yet it's also inspiring. So if people have those types of things in their life, and they might not be to the grand scale that you are actually, you know, standing up for, Jamie, in life. However, on a smaller scale, some people might have a relation with that, as far as this, is this inspiring or is it fatiguing? And it can be both. And so, you know, the body can still have that same type of reaction inside of itself. So it's okay to have both. So if people are wondering, like, can it be both? It can be both. I love that. So the first step you were talking about in your burnout kind of, you know, observation of self is to take that breath. If somebody sees it in you and they comment, and instead of being reactive or, you know, defensive or justify, explain or defend yourself, just simply, hey, thanks. And just look at it. So that observation piece is awesome. And then I heard you say that the second thing you do is to get curious, mind, body, and spirit, and to really check in with that. One of the things that I wanted to bring up, and I don't know who it was, back a little bit, but they made a comment about, what do you do when you're the only one? Like, nobody else can help you. It is 100% your responsibility. And I want to address this piece with this burnout, because we as a society, I don't know how we got there, but we have this really interesting mindset around asking for help, right? Asking for help. We get this illusion that we're separate from, mm-hmm. and that we have to do it all by ourselves. But let's be honest, we are not functioning in this world as a separate entity. I don't know. I live in, you know, a home where somebody mows my lawn, that shovels my snow, that does all these things for me.
You do?
I'm walking around. Yeah. Awesome. I'm walking around, you know, with this mindset of, I have to do everything myself. And the reality is we don't. And so if you're one of those people in this burnout stage, I'd invite you first, you know, step number three is, what's your mind making up? What's the story you're creating? You may have to do a lot of things by yourself. Or maybe you might need to kind of eat a little humble pie and say, I'm going to extend myself out to ask for some help and support.
Mm-hmm. So Amanda said, can I interject? Amanda said something really cool right now. Can you see the comments, love?
I can, but my light's really bright. So I'm like,
okay. And I'm sorry, I'm like kind of ducking around because I'm not at my office. So I'm trying to deal with the producers because my camera is behind there. So I apologize. Amanda said, I like who I am. So I don't always like when someone's picking me apart. And that's kind of what we're talking about is, you know, burnout a lot of times can come when somebody's judging you. Are you really burning out, or is somebody mirroring to you and judging you? So that was kind of really relevant to what you were talking about.
Yeah. That avoiding of judgment. Nobody mm-hmm. likes to be judged. You know, that's what our whole topic was last week. Nobody likes to feel judged. And so that's,
you unless know, it's that's positive. Okay. I like to be like, when people are like, ooh, you look good. Oh, you're pretty. Oh my gosh, you're so smart. Oh my gosh. Love it. Judge. Your hat looks so cute. Your hair is on point.
How often do people say that, though?
What part?
They do. Well, you know, some people allow that in, but it's funny because our brain actually takes mm-hmm. that in for about a second. And then, you know, what they do is, you know, our mind attaches to what the negative thing that somebody said maybe last week about us that, you know, was judgmental. So, I like this idea of, if you're looking at a burnout place, observe yourself, get curious, mind, body, and spirit. How are you actually doing? And it's always up to you. Like, let it be okay for you to decide, like you did, Jamie. You know, actually, what's funny is I said I'm tired, but I've really been getting great sleep, right? Like, check in with yourself and leave this external world's opinion of you out, you know?
It's amazing and hilarious. Yeah, I love it. Bring it. I'm so funny. I actually do like myself. I think I'm really funny, but the hard part, as you know, because you're my good friend and like my sister, is I have to balance my sense of humor with professionalism. Otherwise, I get myself in trouble.
You do get yourself in trouble, but it's kind of fun when you get in trouble. I appreciate when you get in trouble because I laugh about it. Okay, any other thing in there? And then okay. I want to go into, like, why do we get into burnout in the first place?
Okay, I do. I want to address what Amanda said because she's yes. awesome and commenting. And she said her BCBA is always nitpicking her. So for those of you watching that don't know, BCBA is a board-certified behavior analyst. Mm-hmm. So I do have my certification in behavior analysis. I know what she's talking about. Let's talk about the field of psychology in general. And then we'll get back to what you were going to say, Cindy, because mm-hmm. Amanda... So yeah, that's the balance between when you go see a clinician, either a psychologist or a marriage and family therapist, or you have a child, BCBAs, board certified behavior analysts, are usually used for children or in the workplace. So they tend to be involved in problem behaviors, right? So you have a behavior and we need to improve it. And so we're going to analyze it. And then, yeah, they're going to nitpick you. And I recall that she can be passive aggressive. Yikes. So when you're going to a counselor, if you will, globally, that's that counselor's job is to kind of, you have to point out the negative or find the gap and where here you are here and you got to improve here. So I'll let you take it over, Cindy. It's like, you're burnt out because we're judging that you're either negative all the time, you're complaining, you're passive aggressive, you're ungrateful, your physiology is off. And so here in comes clinician, or in your case, you're a certified coach. You come in as a coach. And then how do you handle that in terms of fixing the gap?
Okay, so if I understand what you're saying in this piece, so this is what is interesting. So people come in, whether they're going to see a counselor or a coach or whatever, and they sit down and they really want some solution, like, why am I here and why can't I get where I want to go? And so in this place of burnout, they share their story, right? Like, the story is relevant only to find the lesson in the story. The story itself doesn't actually always matter. It's about the lesson, the story that somebody's trying to move from or move, you know, through. So when you sit down, it's very interesting how people feel judged. Like, so you as a, you know, a marriage and family therapist, here's what we're looking at, you know, this is what we're dealing with. And you're making this judgment. Yeah. You're making the judgment based on they're seeking resolution. They're seeking clarity and understanding, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So in coaching, we do it, you know, it's similar in the sense of in coaching, I call it the story release, and they come in and they like throw it down. Right. And then the next stage is to pull out what I observed or what they said, what they were saying all along. But it's this piece of really trying to leave that judgment out. We judge ourselves so much. And that's part of the burnout too. We are exhausted from judging ourselves of getting it right to, you know, are we enough? You know, will I be rejected? Can I trust myself? We're always running that. So that it's like this double-edged sword of this burnout. Not only are we worried about what's coming at us, but we're worried about what we're dealing with inside ourselves. So it's just kind of an interesting thing. When you do sit down with somebody such as myself or Jamie, you're coming in for, hey, I need support. I don't want to feel like this anymore. But then that piece of them, that egoic side, doesn't want to feel judged. And so it's that finding that happy space, like the non-resistant message back to, you know, this is what you shared and you're here seeking support and help. And let's move you through that. So that's kind of an interesting thing when you're dealing with, you know, somebody such as a coach or a clinician.
Mm-hmm. It's really just frustration and I'm on burnout big time. I need a time out. We have to change who we are in order to help our kids. That self-reflection work is exhausting. Tammy, thank you for sharing too. I need to learn how to have a consistent self-care routine so I don't mm-hmm. have to recover from so much burnout. Yeah.
No, totally. And that goes back to those modalities, right? The modalities of healing and learning. I'm still learning the lesson of how do I prevent my own burnout? Because I do love doing so many things. I could be doing stuff constantly. People would say, how do you do it? I'm like, I don't know. I don't think about it. I just have so much fun, right? But there comes a point, like last week, I was peopled out. You can ask anybody. I could handle my family, my kids, my mom. Like, I was totally peopled out. I didn't want to be around a ton of people because I'm constantly around a lot of people, but I had to own my own stuff there. But those are the modalities, the relationship, the health, the money and career. And burnout goes into, if you watch this, when we can't get ourselves out of this chronic burnout, this chronic grind and go, 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 we'll get a cold. Our back will hurt. We'll trip and fall. You know, we'll do something physically because we're that exhausted. So that piece, I can't remember what you just said her name was, that talks about self-care. It's just important that we're not, you know, backtracking, trying to put self-care back in after we've run ourselves to the end of the line and we're so exhausted and ran right into the concrete wall, you know. So to avoid that high level of fatigue is huge. So to have that self-care in, we'll put that as our number four, to really be aware of your self-care. You know,
I think another way to avoid the other way to deal with burnout is aligning yourself with like-minded people and being active in the community. So aligning
your connection.
Because for many of us, you can't change that you're a single mother of four. I can't change that I deal with special needs population and, you know, highly tumultuous political issues. And so embracing that and learning to take that on, that was your, however you want to look at it, we can get into that too later, is your gift, you know, your lot in life. But surrounding yourself with people who are positive, who are like-minded, and those, and then getting involved and active in your community upon which you surround yourself with. So I just think that's super crucial when you feel like you're burning out, because burnout can feel helpless, like learn helplessness models, and that you keep trying and you're hitting a wall. You're going to feel that way if you're isolated and you're not surrounded with other positive people that are action orientated.
Yeah. And that piece, like you were saying, you know, be around like-minded people. And some of that just has to do with allowing yourself to catch your breath, not defending, explaining, or justifying what you're doing, that they understand you. So not always being in this constant grind of a fight to prove something, but just like be with people that are like-minded, even for, you know, an evening, a dinner, just to breathe and not always be in this fight to prove your worth, prove your value, prove your point. And that connection, you know, to have that community. And that goes back to that place of feeling like you're always alone, that you're the only one that can do this stuff. And even if that community or that, you know, that connection with people is based on they understand and relate to me, they might not be able to help and support me, but they can relate to me. And that common ground just helps people feel like, okay, I'm not alone. I may be finding in my head that I feel like I have to do everything alone, but at least I'm not alone in feeling like that. So that's a great, great thing. Stay connected. Be around like-minded people when you're feeling really burned out, and taking time, you know. For me, I know I was just talking to somebody today and they said, what was one of the ways that you actually started to kind of stop this or stop my perpetual running or processing? Because like burnout is that over-processing. Our mind just never, never stops. And, you know, Sage always talks about that, somebody that we both learned from, that it's, the mind isn't, the person next to you isn't making you exhausted. Your mind is making you exhausted in relationship to what you believe the person's doing or something externally. But my overprocessing can be exhausting. And what I used to do is I used to be an overprocessor.
Do you mean like your thoughts overprocessing, like the chatter?
Yeah, trying to figure it out. I was a high K for a long time, knowing for certain. So I was always trying to figure out how to get from point A to point F perfectly. And if I couldn't do that, then I wouldn't do it because I needed to know exactly that I could get myself there. So overprocessing. The other thing that I find in burnout cases is, are you oversharing? Overtelling your story that can exhaust you physically, energetically to do that. But then also you're opening yourself up to all these opinions of
and
others.
Watching how you tell your story.
Yes, exactly.
The delivery of the story. It was funny. I was on the phone when I was driving from downtown back out here for a client. I was talking to a producer who's doing a documentary show on some of my work. And he called me, said, look, like we filmed an hour and a half and your story is just so incredible. And I don't know how to cut it down to 5 minutes, let alone 20. Cause we, you know, they keep extending it. And he says, and we need a follow-up because like crazy story. And the way that you tell the story is so empowering because no matter what you've gone through, like you just, you're like a boxer. You're just like, ding, 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 round, let's go. And he said, it's like how you tell the story is so important. So I think that should be, like you just said, is on that checklist when you're checking in. I guess we can go back to full circle when I said physical, emotional, spiritual. Under the physical is like looking at what are you doing and sequentially, are you eating healthy? Are you exercising? Are you meditating? Are you doing yoga? But like you said, emotionally, how are you telling your story? Not just what is your story and repeating your story, but listening conscientiously, like we talked about it. Are you telling that story like you're a victim over and over and over? And I'm going to let you speak to that. Like when you clearly have been victimized, like you're a victim of domestic violence, or you're a victim of somebody having an affair, or you're a victim of a child that has an injury that people are denying has occurred, or you're a victim. But I mean, we can all find something to victimize ourselves. How do you help other people when they're burning out that drama self-talk in their mind to see that?
Well, and yeah, we'll go right to this victim piece. Like people have been victimized. Like they can tell the story, like I can prove to you and we can validate that, you know, victimization. But most importantly, it's not to take that away from them, but instead invite them from that spot based on then they can feel empowered and then they can move on in their life. Because if we allow them to stay victimized, then they're always in this disempowered state. So it's not to take that experience away from them. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, you know, was I victimized as part of, you know, this double life that my ex-husband had? Well, I guess, yes. But that's super important to look at that. And I want to jump back. Tammy mentioned something that's important, if you can see that. She said that she finds herself sharing with the wrong people. Right? So there are a couple different things. Sometimes we share with people that we know that they'll validate our victimization or a disempowerment or somebody wronged us or whatever. Okay. Sometimes we're actually looking for somebody to pick a fight with. Like we're ready to have this conflict about whatever it may be. Right?
Like people like that.
They like that. And sometimes when you're in burnout, you're exhausted or you're on fire and you're ready for a freaking awesome fight. So watch that in your burnout. Sometimes you're like, I'm so tired. I'm so tired. I'm so tired. And sometimes you're like, come on, somebody pick a fight. Like, let's do this because that energizes them. That gets that energy out. That says they can keep going, right? Like I got more in me. So sometimes people will pick fights too, but looking at that whole piece around who are you choosing to tell your burnout story to? Like I said, mm-hmm. I can't wait till I don't ever have that coming out of my mouth again. What are you doing? Lying on a beach in Hawaii, doing nothing. What are you doing? Oh my God, I'm so tired. I'm like, you can have it. I don't want that trophy anymore. I don't want that trophy anymore. I want, you know, I want to be passionate in my life, not burned out. There's a difference.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We had a little technology interruption. Hopefully it's okay for the producers, but we'll keep plugging away. Thanks, ladies. Thanks, gentlemen, for staying in here. And if you guys have any questions on this topic, please feel free to comment away. Burnout. Go ahead. What were you going
to
say?
I wanted to circle back. Why do we even go? Why do we get to this place of burnout in the first place? You know, why do we get burned out? And if we could go back to the four addictions of the mind, perfectionism, intensity, focusing on not what's not working and knowing for certain, this is a really good place for you to identify how does my mind work and what is it playing with most often in this place of, I gotta go, I gotta go, I gotta go, I go. For example, those people that are high perfectionists, their burnout comes from, I've got to get it right 100% of the time because I am perfect. You know, I am perfect. Therefore, I get tired of having to be perfect. People that are high P, they're exhausted from that. Okay. The high I's, the intensity, they are having a blast and absolutely exhausted, trying to keep all these balls in the air, trying to run around. It's chaotic. It's, you know, it's intense. There's drama and they get burned out from all the drama, but yet part of it is really inviting in their mind, like all of that constant chatter. There's so much going on, but it can be fatiguing. Then you have that person that's focusing chronically on what's not working. You know, those people that never stop complaining. So energetically, always complaining, always talking about what's not working, gives you the sensation that the mind is so fatigued from, you know, connecting to all of this crap that there's burnout and there's hopelessness there. Like, can this ever stop? Okay. Can I ever feel better? And then that knowing for certain, the K part of that addiction, you know, as far as the burnout goes, people trying to figure out, this was me for a long time in my life. How do I get from this point to this point? And I need to figure out every single way for me to get there and every detail from this point to this point. And if I can't, I can't do it that way. So then I have to start over. I can't do it this way. Oh, okay. I'll try to do that. Oh, I can't do it that way. Plan C. I can't do it that way. People get a high level of burnout trying to figure out how to make everything perfect before they step into it. So that's just something to be aware of too. Like, what kind of burnout person are you? Are you a perfectionist burnout? Are you an intensity burnout? Are you a person that focuses, you're so tired but can't stop talking about what's negative burnout type of person? Or what about a person that's burned out from trying to figure out how to get it right so you don't have to be afraid that something's going to go wrong because you figured out every last detail?
Or all of the above.
Or all of the freaking above. That's
Victoria Secret Sexy Pink.
Right? I know. I think we should have shirts that say pink. We should get Victoria's Secret pink t-shirts.
I think we'll get in trouble for copyright.
God, I know.
Trademark or trademark violation.
Well, we could.
I don't know. Get. I don't know if they have a trademark on pink. But
I don't know.
I'll have my lawyers look into that one, too.
Amanda just said, yo, all the above. Exactly. And that's why you're like a super doer, overachiever, burnout person. Like, who doesn't like to over super do? I'm a recovering over super doer in my life and burnout, you know? Yeah. You can be all of those.
One thing that I know I could share has helped me with burnout is staying really in the moment. We talk a lot about that ability to stay in the moment. And I just learning like the Matrix to just like block other people out and their own stuff. I mean, I hear people's stuff all the time, which is great because I'm empathic and I'm supportive. I think I'm clear in terms of, look, your importance and your issues are just as valid to you as mine are to me. Objectively, I always say as a clinician, we can line up, like I'm a research mind, right? So we can line up 10 people and ask 10 people to make a judgment call or to rate something. And then that pretty much gives us an accounting of what we would all census-wise agree on. So I think everybody would agree, if you can learn to master staying in the right now, right here, and not let anybody else into your bubble, into your circle, no matter what's going on, whether it's somebody screaming at you because you were texting and driving and you were guilty and you knew it and they were like, you know, or you have a severely, you know, special needs son that's smearing his poop all over the wall, or you're going through your husband's cell phone and you find that he's texting somebody else, you know, there's a whole array. Is just to be able to, like, right there in that split second, stay here, stay now, and like block it out like a matrix. Just see yourself in your own little spiritual cocoon of strength and armor. I know that has gotten me through the craziness that I've had to go through.
For sure. For sure. And that's that whole piece, like you were saying, this little coat of armor and getting clear, like what's so bad in this red hot second. And quite honestly, there are times like, yeah, if you're going through your husband's cell phone and you find that or busted. Poop on the wall, right? In that red hot second, yeah, it's hard to keep that out. But at least if you can acknowledge like what's really so wrong in this red hot second, oh, I just found out something that I wasn't aware of. And then just breathe. Even if you just hold it, but hold it externally outside your body and honor, yeah, there actually is something that is upsetting me in this moment. But you don't have to take all those other things that aren't really upsetting that your mind is trying to attach to and just be like, right now, this one is truly upsetting me. But a lot of that outside noise that we don't need to have in our life and we don't need to pick up at that time, yeah, keep it outside, you know, outside, like you said, of that matrix. For sure. It's not easy.
What is the present moment? So let's break that down too into strategies of the actual present moment. I couldn't get to that until I learned to calm the chatter in my mind. And I will be talking about that tonight for the group of women that I'm helping out later. And just so honored to be there for is how did I get to being able to stay in the present moment? And that was learning to stop the chatter in my mind. And that really came through two forms of prayer and meditation.
Okay.
So
yeah.
I had to learn to just sit through the Jamie voice that just would not shut the up.
And how do you do that? By taking
like the train and the dogs in the background because I'm at home. Like that's a perfect example. My mind right now can hear the train on this side. I can hear the dogs in the backyard. And then I'm like, focus, you're here talking to Cindy and doing a radio show. It's like all of blah, 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 blah. So just learning to literally, I love compartmentalization. I love it. Like these little boxes is just staying here and letting the thoughts go and not judge the thoughts. That was my first step when I learned to meditate out and just be in acceptance and being one with when I'm right here, right now, just let them come and don't judge them. That was like the first thing. There's other ways like mantras, you know, you can pick a mantra or a positive thought or a prayer. You know, I use a lot. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And when those thoughts are like way out of control, I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. I can do all things through Christ who or God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change and the courage to change the things I can and the wisdom to know the difference. Like just taking control, like right here, right now of those chatter things that you think you can't control. So I hope that makes sense with like the here and the now and some tools and techniques on how to grapple that.
Yeah, grapple, for sure. Grapple, raffle. I can't see it. Are other people showing? Can you see that part? Like, are other people commenting about some of the things that they do?
Yeah, like Susan's saying the voices get loud and that they feel severely challenged or mindful mantra, speaking my own language. Yeah, okay. Things like that.
So one of the things that I talk to teens about is just envisioning like this train, you know, coming through your mind, like it's coming in and instead of stopping it and looking at every single car, you know, like if, you know, if you've ever sat for a 10 minute train, that would be exhausting. So it's just like to allow it to just keep going through your mind. If you just like, oh, there's a whole bunch of content in there, but if I decide to look at it later, I can. That's the other thing is to take that breath and then just say, hey, so I could look at this right now, but it's not my highest and best moment. If I decide later, I want to look at it, I will. One of my favorite things that I use is this statement right before what I say. My mind is making up. So with this constant chatter, like I think Susan said that it gets really loud. If you put that statement, my mind is making up, before all of the information as it's coming through, like, oh, my mind is making up that this isn't going to be okay. Or my mind is making up that the train is distraction or the distracting. Or my mind is making up that the dogs are distracting this radio show. Whatever it is. Like your mind is just making up all of this stuff and that can be fatiguing. So just to like start to put my mind is making up and eventually the mind just is not interested in, you know, making up because you keep discounting what it's trying to create and you're not buying it. You're not grabbing onto it and making it a fact and making it true. So it's like my mind is making up that that's happening and the mind just is, it gets tired of you just kind of tossing it like no big deal, no big deal. Because it wants that to be a big deal. It wants you to process it. It wants you to get in there. It wants you to judge it. So my mind is making up is a really, really nice way to just kind of deaden that need to process, because we overprocess.
Mm-hmm.
Those are a couple of things that I do.
You know, the train analogy is super interesting that you brought that up about when you see a train going by and you just watch the, what are they called? Anybody know what they're called? The, I know there's a name for them. The big things that end up on the back of trucks that are congesting our freeways.
Containers.
Yeah, like the containers. I'll take that.
Mm-hmm. I think they are called containers. I think they are.
Uh-huh. So interesting about that is when I was trained in EMDR, eye movement desensitization and reprocessing, and it's similar. Susan's asking about doing like subconscious part work. So we use the analogy of a train a lot too, is being able to just sit back as if you're watching a train, but on that train is the story. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, that's the dream. That's the story that your mind assigned to it. And then each of those compartments, as you're watching the train go by like a movie, we break down into your thoughts, your feelings, and your physiological sensations. So what do you think about that story? What is that thought process bringing up for you that's causing these feelings, this sadness, this anger, this fear, this frozenness, and then influencing your physiology? Where do you feel it in your body? Do you have a headache? Do you feel hot? Is your heart racing? Is your stomach mm-hmm. hurt? And it's so fascinating that you brought that up, because I just think that's perfect for teaching people some tools and some strategies for, you know, what do you do next when you feel the burnout coming on, is just the train. Like, that's, we should do a whole segment using train analogies, and then all the kids with autism could come on that are obsessed with trains.
That would be so awesome.
It would be great.
I love it. No, it's true. And here's the thing, part of, you know, so what's your theory, or what's your thought on why is the story in our society so important, Jamie? Why is it?
How many stories? I mean, there's like love stories, there's drama stories, action stories, hurt stories, lost stories. What are we talking about?
So why are they important? Any story. For example, is the story about, like, why do we tell our story? Like, what's the insignificant? Like, if we didn't have a memory that could remember our story, you know, the doom and the gloom, the hurt and the pain, the sadness, the joy, the passion, the excitement, the adventure. And we were only seeking really what resonated with us in that present moment of who we are in that present moment. Like, what will we choose? But does our story create, you know, for me, like, sometimes people want to tell their story because they want to relate, like we were talking about earlier, just having that relatability, not feeling alone. But it's very interesting. I think we could do a show on this. What is the importance, and why do we hold this notion or this belief in our mind that without our story, who are we? And why do we seek to tell our story? It's so funny.
I'm taking notes because as soon as you said that, for me, I saw a mom jump on here who I recently had the honor of meeting. It's almost like finding your long lost sibling. You know, we were part of this class action lawsuit almost 20 years ago with our kids being vaccine injured, and then we were exited out of court, and many of us for several reasons. So I saw her jump on here. She's been on here for a while. And as soon as you said that, my mind said justice.
Yeah.
I want justice. And that's like almost everything that, like, when I think about people are like, why do you do what you do? Like, you've just sacrificed your kids and your career. And I was like, I want justice. Give me my justice.
Yeah.
And then balancing that, I've talked to Sage and my own, you know, private counselor about these kinds of issues that I'm happy to vulnerably share is, well, what does justice mean to you? Is that a vengeful, energetic, like, I want you to pay. You poisoned my kid, and then you denied him services, and you called me crazy, and I had to take drugs, and you took my kid. And the story goes on and on, right? Like, I want justice. And then, but energetically versus, I just want what's just. I want justice. I want to have his name restored, and I want people to understand so you can use my story, and then we can spread love and we can spread light. Do you see how quickly, like, those two things can just, justice can be interpreted one way versus that way? And by the way, I am a really good actress, if you didn't notice. Surprise! But authentically and vulnerably, does that make sense? I hope that helps everybody. Is like, what drives you and the purpose of your story? And it can be multi-layered and faceted, and it doesn't just have to be one thing. But like, to me, what just happened between us and your, you know, saying that kind of thing was like super instrumental for me.
That's awesome. I
Send
love
me a
it,
bill,
and
baby.
I love how you brought that around. And how is our story contributing to our burnout? What are we holding beliefs? What are we still striving for? Is it justice? Like, what is this? What is this? Because our burnout is in there, in that story.
Yeah.
Burnout's in there. It doesn't have to be a bad thing. And it doesn't have to, you know, like you just explained that justice piece so eloquently, like beautifully, you know, that it's okay to find that in there. And I don't know who said, please do a show on that, but we will.
Sure.
We'll definitely do that.
Can you elaborate, Susan, like a show just on justice? Because that'd be awesome.
Oh, man, that would be heated.
But, I don't know why, but Lorena Bobbitt just totally popped into my head when it came to marital issues.
Oh, my God. I just talked about her the other day. That's so funny.
Cut it off.
I think she was talking about a show on the story. Like, what is, you know, why do okay. What is so important about
thank you
our stories? Is that what she said?
No, thank you. It was awesome. She said to get to the root cause of the burnout. So yeah,
yes.
Like tonight's show, as we're wrapping up, because I do have to run and our producers are going to kick our butts if we're over. But
so the root cause of burnout.
Yes. Okay. Yes. I love that.
Yeah,
thank you, that Melinda. Good. Like justice, accountability, acceptance. Like, yeah, like what drives us? So.
Okay.
Cool.
Okay. All right. We've got those down. We both wrote those down. You can see us writing.
And if I could just finish it up too, is what also drives the justice behind me is it's helping other people, being of service, not wanting other people to have to go through what I went through. So there is it's just so many different reasons. And for you too, I'm sure you don't want other people to experience what you experienced. You just want people to be happy and healthy.
Yeah, I agree. 100%. That's the whole point, right? We want to feel good. And we get to, and whatever that looks like.
Yep.
Awesome.
Cool. Well, thank you everybody for joining us on Armed Radio. Thank our producers over there. I hope you guys all have an amazing week. And thanks for joining us on Armed Radio. Sure. I'm your host, Jamie Lynn, with the amazing Cindy Lee at So What's Next.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, that's done. So the producers can cut it there. Now I'm going to finish really quick. Before I go, everybody go to Senator Pants. This is my call to action for today.
Vote. Just go and vote.
Go to vote. But I have a call to action, man.
You can call to action. I'm not. You go. Do it, girl.
Okay.
Do it.
Okay. Go vote. I'm not telling you what to vote for. Just peace, hope, freedom, love.
I'm gonna tell you what to vote for.
Do you guys like my red lipstick?
I do. I need some of that.
You totally just missed the innuendo. Vote red.
All right.
You don't see a blue hat. You don't see blue lipstick on, do you?
Oh my God, you're killing me. God, go to work. You gotta get to that.
Okay, I gotta go.
Inspire stressed out moms. Yep. Bye,
everybody. Okay, bye. Love you all. Bye. Peace, hope, freedom.
She's just a girl and she's on fire, hotter than a fantasy, lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire, filled with catastrophe, but she knows she can fly away.